swear that you've seen me. Yes, you've seen me here before. Before. And so don't tell it. Don't tell it otherwise. This voice, this particular voice, yes, you've heard it before. Before. And so don't you dare tell it. Don't you dare tell it otherwise. No wonder why the road seems so long. 'Cause I had done it all before. And I won. You felt this feeling. Tell me, don't be ashamed. You felt it before. Before. And so don't tell me, don't tell me otherwise. I almost forgot, foolish me, I almost forgot. Forgot that where I'm from, we see the rain before the rain even starts to rain. No wonder why you've been buggering me. This walk, it's a previous journey. And I won.
Good evening, everyone. Hello. My name is Ashok Mathur. I'm the Dean of Graduate Studies and the Interim Vice President of Research and Innovation here at OCAD University. I want to welcome everyone here. As we know, our brick and mortar establishment of OCAD University is in downtown Toronto. Toronto is the traditional home of the Haudenosaunee, the Anishinaabe, the Huron-Wendat, and the Mississauga of the Credit. And I want to recognize too that Toronto is also the home to the largest urban indigenous population in the province, and the fourth largest in the country, and of course home to a large Métis community as well. I think it's very important for us to recognize and acknowledge this as we begin an event such as today, which is going to be a wonderful event, because of where we're at and where we're situated, and I think it portends a very important conversations to come. I want to also let people know that this will be recorded, and so please be aware of that. If you're speaking, you want to turn off your camera. If you would like to do that, not be recorded, this, let us know. Also, that it's closed captioned, and at the bottom of the screen is an access for you to get a closed captioning of this. And finally, I want to let you know that there will be a chat at the end of the talk. So the chat screen, which is not enabled for you right now, will be enabled then. And you'll be able to have some engagement with the panelists. Before I get to this introduction, I want to point to something behind me, which is some moccasin vamps that were made by my good friend and colleague Peter Morin from the Tahltan Nation. They are representative of Ganesh, who in the Hindu cosmology is the Lord of Obstacles, or consider the Lord of Remover of Obstacles. And the reason I decided to use this as a background today is because of a very long and very wonderful history that I've enjoyed with just people like Andrea Fatona, who I'll be introducing shortly, but with Camille Turner and with Rinaldo Walcott as well. I see them and the people that are working on spaces and places like this as those who look at obstacles as a challenge and figure out ways to remove them for those who need them removed. And sometimes, and I will have to say this, sometimes we put those obstacles in the way to slow things down a bit because things have to be challenged in particular manners and forms. So I put that as a broad introduction. I'm going to start by introducing tonight's event, and then I'll turn it over to our president at OCAD for a brief statement, and then I'll come back to me to introduce Andrea and the panel. So recognizing and appreciating contemporary Black artists, craftspeople, curators, and critics who for so long have been underrepresented in Canadian culture, that is the focus of the Center for the Study of Black Canadian Diaspora, which is being launched right now. It was established and led by Associate Professor, Art Curator, Scholar, and Canada Research Chair, Dr. Andrea Fatone. And the center is going to comprehensively showcase in a single central platform the artistic creations of contemporary Black visual artists and craftspeople in this country whose work has historically been underrecognized or ignored altogether. The center is really the next chapter of three decades of work by Dr. Fatone to rectify the absence of Black visual fine artists, media artists, and craftspeople who, due to decades of pervasive systemic racism, have been excluded from the Canadian art world's official record of catalogs, galleries, and reviewers. This absence has extended to the contributions of Black art curators and critics whose work also has generally been relegated to the margins of the sector. So the center that we're talking about here, the space that we're talking about, that Andrea and so many people that she and others have built together is an idea whose time has definitely come, and it will create opportunities and challenges as we move forward unfazingly into the future. So the Center for the Study of Black Canadian Diaspora, launching right now at this site, the State of Blackness Revisited. It's free, as you know, and it will be a conversation between Andrea Fatone and scholars and artists, Rinaldo Walcott and artist Camille Turner, on the shifts in the sphere of Black Canadian cultural production. I'll speak a bit more to Andrea in a moment, but at this moment, what I'd like to do is turn the stage over to the president of OCAD, Anna Serrano, for her opening remarks. Please, Anna.
Thank you very much, Ashok, and so lovely to see everyone tonight. This is really, really, I'm super honored to be here. I've had the pleasure of knowing Dr. Andrea Fatone over the course of the past, 7 months that I've been president here at OCAD, and have known some of our speakers tonight for a lot longer than that, but as Ashok has rightly pointed out, tonight is really this glorious, momentous occasion when we will focus on Black cultural production in Canada and truly honor the incredible achievements of our faculty member, art curator, and scholar, Dr. Andrea Fatone. At OCAD University, we provide a unique creative studio-based education that empowers emerging artists, designers, makers, creators, and innovators to develop their talents and embark on their chosen career. But as Ashok has articulately spoken about already, we know that historically, the works of Black artists have largely been erased from the national imagination shaped by Canadian visual culture. Their work has often been overlooked by gallery owners, curators, critics, and other key players in the mainstream visual art world. The official record of art does not tell the full story of cultural creation in Canada. Dr. Andrea Fatone has been working for many, many years to rectify this absence and promote a more equitable playing field for Black visual artists. As an associate professor in the Faculty of Art and researcher at OCADU, she is focused on expanding our understanding of Canadian Black contemporary cultural production from 1987 to the present. In 2014, she organized the State of Blackness from Production to Presentation, a conference on Black diasporic artistic practice and representation in Canada. This two-day interdisciplinary event brought together 42 artists, curators, academics, and students to problem solve challenges and explore future opportunities to raise the profile of Black artists, critics, and cultural producers. And I know many of you here tonight probably were there in the auditorium in 2014 at that momentous occasion as well. But this conference was just a starting point for her. At a forum at the 2015 Venice Biennale, she raised awareness about the invisibility of Black Canadian artists, curators, and critics in the international sphere. In 2017, she collaborated with an artist-run nonprofit video art distributor, VTape, to compile data on Black Canadian video production from the late 90s to the present. And as part of last year's Black History Month Fellow Florence program, Dr. Fatona helped organize a research residency at OCADU's Florence Studio for young, gifted Black artists from across Italy. This 10-day experience focused on diasporic dialogue and the challenges and possibilities facing these artists. Dr. Fatona's work was bolstered with her appointment as a Tier 2 Canada Research Chair in Canadian Black Diasporic Cultural Production, officially announced last December. In this role, she will continue working to move the needle on how we acknowledge, include, and create space for art makers from our country's Black communities. And tonight, we are celebrating a significant step forward in Dr. Fatona's work with the launch of the Center for the Study of Black Canadian Diaspora. This center will conduct important research and raise awareness of underrepresented contemporary Black artists, craftspeople, curators, and critics. We're excited about the knowledge and opportunities it will create. At OCADU, we know it stands to enrich the way we teach and learn while allowing our institution to better live by our values of diversity, equity, and inclusion. More broadly, at a time when we are more aware than ever of the problems of systemic anti-Black racism, the center offers much needed hope and solutions for increasing recognition and appreciation of Black art and culture. So 7 years after Dr. Fatona's State of Blackness conference, how far have we come in acknowledging and amplifying Black culture makers? That's what we'll try to determine in tonight's conversation between two participants from that conference, artist and OCADU graduate Camille Turner and scholar Dr. Rinaldo Walcott. They will discuss and debate the evolution of mainstream representation of Black artistic practice in Canada, where we've been, where we are today, and what the future could look like. It's clear that we still have much work to do in recognizing the diverse contributions of Black artists. Making progress in this direction is essential to creating the truly fair and inclusive society we all want. But if there's one thing we know for sure, it's that the future for Black culture makers in Canada now looks brighter, thanks to Dr. Fatona's groundworking work at OCADU. So thank you. And we're really looking forward to tonight.
Thank you so much for this, Anna. You've done a wonderful job of introducing the full context of Andrea's work. So I'm going to be very brief in my formal introduction here. As I've mentioned before, and as of course Anna referenced, Andrea Fatona is an independent art curator and scholar. She was a former director of the graduate program in criticism and curatorial practice here at OCAD. And she's been working on for years, as I mentioned before, to rectify the absence of Black visual art from official records, the art critics reviews, art archives, and other avenues of representation. So this program, as she will talk to, and as we move on to this panel, will make visible and provide access to the works of contemporary Black artists, craftspeople, curators, and critics in Canada who have been historically erased from the imaginary of Canadian visual culture. I just want to say one thing about the importance of community in all of this. I'm a bit nervous here right now because I'm so honored and so chuffed to be asked by Andrea to make this introduction and with this incredible panel. You know, many years ago, I directed a residency at the Banff Center, and I got this call out of the blue from Camille Turner saying, "Hey, can I come and play?" And I said, "Yeah, come play." And we had this wonderful time together. Every time I used to visit Toronto, the first person in my Rolodex was Rinaldo. "Hey, Rinaldo, let's get together and talk." And Andrea has a very particular place in my heart. When this job came up for me as a Dean of Graduate Studies, I wasn't sure about it. I wasn't sure about institutional commitment. And the very first call I made was to Dr. Fatona. And I said, I wrote to her and I said, "Andrea, what do you think of this?" And she wrote back, she said, "Give me a call." And I called her and she said, "Yes, it's the right time and place." And that's why I'm here, thanks to her, to her largesse, to her incredible generosity within communities. She is a scholar with impeccable capacity, a long history of community building. She's so respected in her field of study, and the work that she's already accomplished resonates nationally and internationally. We are so fortunate to have her here, and I am very fortunate to be able to turn this over to my very, very good friend, Andrea Fatona.
Thank you, Ashok, and thank you, President Serrano, for your really kind and generous introduction. I also want to say that my work really builds on a very long line of folks doing this work, some of them who've been erased and they're no longer producing work in Canada. Some of them are here, still really slogging away at it. So where I am at and what I'm doing is really just another phase in terms of the labor and real labor of Black cultural producers, critics, and activists in this country who've made it possible for me to do what I'm doing. I'd also like to say that I am here in Toronto, in this location. Ashok did a bit of a land acknowledgement. I think it's really important for me to talk about the place that I'm in, talk about the local, and as a Black diasporic subject, also really talk about the ways in which my locality really gestures, my being here also gestures to spaces elsewhere. And this is what's so interesting and important to me around the kinds of works people like Rinaldo and Camille are doing. I also want to say that Camille Turner and Rinaldo Walcott are my friends. They became my friends through the work that they do. We became friends through work. I think it's really important for me to state the importance of the kinds of intimate and convivial relationships that allow me to do my work. Their insistence on Black Canada, both Rinaldo's and Camille, not only their insistence, but their persistence and consistence with actually looking in at Black Canada, allowing Black Canada to be refracted outwards, really grounds my work. I do the work I do because of their work, but I also do the work I do because of a number of others, as well as I stated before, people like Norbezi Phillip, Lillian Allen, Ayanna Black, Marva Jackson, people like David George Morgan, a number of folks who are on the advisory committee for this center, Sylvia Hamilton, and the list goes on. I just think it's very, very important to always, for me and for us, to state the roots and the kinds of roots that bring us into conversation with each other and to acknowledge, I think, the productive nature of that. I'm not going to take up too much time, so what I'm going to do is introduce both Camille and Rinaldo via their bios, and then we'll launch into the conversation. So I'm going to read from the bios. Camille Turner is an explorer of race, space, home, and belonging. Straddling media, social practice, and performance art, her work has been presented throughout Canada and internationally. Wanted, a collaboration with Kamal Prabai, was shown most recently at the Art Gallery of Ontario and uses the trope of fashion to transform 18th century newspaper posts by Canadian slave owners into contemporary fashion ads. Freedom Tours, created collaboratively with Cree Métis artist Shirley Rondell, is a National Commission of Landmarks 2017 that consists of participatory site-specific events that reimagine and reanimate land and water from Black and Indigenous perspectives. The Afronautic Research Lab is a reading room in which participants encounter buried histories. The Landscape of Forgetting, a walk created collaboratively with Alana Bartol, and Sonic Walk Hush Harbor and the Resistance of Peggy Pompadour evoke sites of Black memory that reimagine the Canadian landscape. Miss Canadiana, one of her earliest projects, challenges perceptions of Canadianness and troubles the unspoken binary of real Canadian and diverse other. Camille is founder of Outer Region, an Afrofuturist performance group. She has lectured at various institutions such as U of T, Ogoma University, Toronto School of Art and the graduate program of OCADU. Camille is also currently completing a PhD at York University. Dr. Rinaldo Walcott is a full professor in the Women and Gender Studies Institute and member of the graduate program at the Institute of Cinema Studies at the University of Toronto. From 2002 to 2007, Rinaldo held the Canada Research Chair of Social Justice and Cultural Studies at OISE. He is the author of Black Like Who, Writing Canada, Writing Black Canada, Insomniac Press, 1997, with a second revised edition in 2003. He's also the editor of Rude, Contemporary Black Canadian Cultural Criticism, also Insomniac Press. The author of Queer Returns, Essays on Multiculturalism, Diaspora and Black Studies, also by Insomniac Press. With Adil Abdelahi, he co-authored Black Life, Post-BLM and the Struggle for Freedom, our books, 2019. As well, Rinaldo is the co-editor with Roy Moodley of Counseling Across and Beyond Cultures, exploring the work of Clement Vontrus in Clinical Practice, University of Toronto Press, 2010. Rinaldo, his most recent book, The Long Emancipation, Moving Forward, Black Freedom, and Essay, is forthcoming from Duke University in April 2021, so next month. And he's recently just published On Property. He was born in Barbados. So I also just want to say that as you know, I invited both Rinaldo and Camille to have this discussion again because they were participants in the initial conference of 2014. We traveled to Venice and Florence together and we've been in conversations. And so when I asked them to come to speak, it was really about, you know, teasing out from a space of the kind of trust that I have in them in terms of their level of analysis and their engagement across not only spaces of Canada, but moving our works outside of the space, that they might be able to think through and engage in some discussion, because much has changed since 2014, particularly in the artistic realm. A number of exhibitions have come to fruition. The AGO has presented solo exhibitions of a number of Black women artists, Winsome, June Clark, Sandra Brewster. The AGO has also installed a global Africa curator. Other galleries that I've just read today, the Oakville Galleries has just installed a Black ED, so has the McLaren Arts Center in Barrie. The VAG has also produced a show with an emerging curator called Where Do We Go From Here? And there's been various other hires across the country. The other thing that's taken place, my institution itself, under the leadership of Dean Dory Tunstall, has led a successful Black cluster hire. So much of what we were calling for through our conversations at that conference, some of it has been heard. I'm very interested for you folks to actually lead us through what you see as the gains and perhaps what some of the pitfalls might be and possible futures that we might dream of, given where we are, where we're at in the present. So I'd like to turn it over to you both. And again, to profusely thank you for accepting the invitation to come and chat.
Should I begin, Camille?
Yes, go ahead.
Okay. So yeah, I think where Andrea left off is where I would like to begin and kind of give some sense of where my comments are coming from, how they're located. So I think Andrea is really correct that since 2014, if in 2014, the scene for visual art in Canada, Black visual art in Canada seemed bereft, by 2021, it doesn't exactly appear that way anymore. But I want to frame my comments nonetheless my opening comments at least, nonetheless, between two moments that are really important for me. So Andrea invoked 2015 and the group of us who traveled to the Venice Biennale to engage in conversation. And the late B.C. Silver, in one of the workshops that we attended in 2015, said something that has haunted me ever since. At one moment in our conversation, she made the point that there was no contemporary art coming from Black Canada. And if folks recall, it was a startling comment, but it has stayed with me all this time. And it continues to haunt me in a particular way. And I'm gonna come back to why it haunts me. And then more recently in 2019, I had the opportunity to be invited to give a number of lectures at the Museum of Contemporary Art, Miami. And on the night that I gave a public lecture to a really informed audience of folks around Black diaspora, around Black Canadian art, and around Black diaspora art, one of the things that happened in the question period was that the names of Black Canadian artists among this group of people who really knew Black diaspora art didn't seem to stick, that the only name they could remember was the name of Stan Douglas. But they could remember all of the African Americans who had recently shown in Canada. So they could remember that Micheline Thomas had shown. They could remember that the Kenyan American artist Wangushi Mutu had shown. But they couldn't remember the names of any Black Canadian artists. And so those two moments are really framing how I'm coming to this moment where since 2014, the scene looks really, in some ways, plentiful. But I'm also curious about what's the buttress that holds up what now looks plentiful. So yes, we've had the shows that Andrea pinpointed. We've had the Here We Are Here at the ROM. Mark Campbell has done a couple of shows on hip hop. We're gonna come to Camille's work in a second. And we've seen Black curators hired. We've seen Black executive directors hired. And we've seen articles and conversations in Canadian art and elsewhere raising these issues and trying to get us to think about the context that might produce a really buoyant scene of Black Canadian art. But the reason BC Silva's comment haunts me, and the reason that my experience at Mocha Miami continues to trouble me and unnerve me, is that I begin to think that part of what's missing from the scene, or what has not yet been fully developed in the scene at this time, is a kind of discourse, a kind of critical co-gathering and co-mingling of ideas, art, critics, artists, that begins to define something about what Black Canadian art looks like. Not that Black Canadian art can have one definition, but if I can give you an example, I think, for instance, the kind of work that Thelma Golden did with something like Black Male when she was at the Whitney, but then when she moved to the Studio Museum, the Freestyle Show. We still haven't really seen a show in Canada that has galvanized the imagination, produced a kind of profound debate that begins to create the space for both deep theoretical understandings of Black Canadian art and to think about the kinds of positions and traditions that the artists themselves are working with. So one of the things that I was really glad to be talking with Camille, because I'm trying to do some of this work in this project that I'm working on called Rethinking the Seas or the Black Aquatic. I can't decide which title it would be. But one of the things that always makes me excited to engage Camille's work and to have conversations with Camille, and I'm constantly bothering her to send me images, is because I think that Camille's work allows us to begin to get at some of the kinds of things that I just said. I think that Camille's work is doing something that I'm trying to now theorize, by thinking about the project from the Biennale of 2019, which is, I see your work as opening up three areas that I think we need to think about as a project of refusal, a project of reconstruction, and a project of reparation, but not reparation in the economic sense. A reparative project that is far much, much deeper than the economic, and that is located in psychic repair and other kinds of repair. So I'm really glad to be having this conversation with you. And those are my opening comments. As we proceed, I will make reference to some other shows and other moments that I think we need to think about. Turn it over to you, Camille.
Oh, thank you, Rinaldo. Yeah, it's interesting what you're saying about this the piece from Newfoundland. It's called Aeronautic Research Lab, Newfoundland.
Exactly.
And I feel like that work kind of started with the trip that we took to Venice when we were all there, and we saw John Acumfra's work, Vertigo Sea. There was something for me that just broke open. There was one panel that said Newfoundland, and I really want to big up Bushra Junaid, because I think Bushra is doing this work, and she has really led the way for me to be able to do the work that I'm doing. Bushra and I saw this together. We all saw it together. But I remember Bushra saying, oh my gosh, you know, we need to get this piece to the rooms in Newfoundland. And there's something about it that is really speaking to this place, to Newfoundland in particular, but, you know, in general, to Canada. And it's really interesting what Acumfra's doing, because he's locating the crises that's happening in the Mediterranean, African people losing their lives in the Mediterranean, by pulling back the camera to look at, you know, where did this come from? What produced it? And looking at transatlantic slavery in, you know, as one big disaster that has spawned so many. So I have to really big up Bushra and the work she's done. The show What Carries Us, that she curated at the Rooms, speaks back to Acumfra's work, locates Newfoundland as a locus where we can look at the Black Atlantic. She included Sandra Brewster, Shelley Miller, myself, and Sonia Boyce, who's a Black British artist. And Acumfra's work was there. You know, we are in conversation with that work. And I think this kind of work really, I don't know, it does what you're talking about. It does that reckoning, or sort of pulling, for me, what's going on, and I see it a little bit differently, maybe. I see the, you know, Michel Rolfe Triot calls it, what does he call it? He calls it the unthinkable, right? I feel like that's what's going on. The unthinkability of Black Canada. I remember when all of us went to Venice. You remember everywhere we went, there people are like, wow, Black Canadian curators. We just saw like a couple of Black Canadian curators, and all of a sudden they're like seeing us all, you know, all the time. And it's just this unthinkability. How can these people even exist, you know? So I feel like in a lot of ways, what we're engaging is the unthinkable, and we're trying to find ways to make it thinkable. We're trying to make, you know, you talked about refusal as well. I mean, that's you know, that's an important part of it as well. But that way of thinking through the historical, you know, that created what's going on in the present. The show that Bushra curated, it you know, there were contemporary artists, but there was also artifacts from the archives. And there was one in particular, this seaman who got washed up on shore in the 19th century, a black seaman. And they had his, things that remained that were a part of this exhibition. So there's something very haunting about this way of, trying to excavate the unthinkable. And I feel like in the work that I'm doing, that's basically what I'm trying to do, is to recover this history and to engage the unthinkable. So I've created something that I call Afronautics, and I've been,
Right.
telling you about this for a while now. This idea of borrowing nonlinear time, the concept of nonlinear time from Afrofuturism, and centering blackness, and then using the imagination as a place from which to make worlds. And thinking about Trio's unthinkability and using it to really, get beyond those thick, opaque, white silences that are basically obscuring what is, but using that those silences as information, as direction, and so creating the Afronautic Research Lab, for instance, is a futuristic reading room where and it's a project that has gone across the country. It's been really interesting seeing the responses, because it really depends on where you're coming from, who you are, what it is that, how you sit within the history. And so what I've done is gathered archival evidence of anti-blackness and black resistance. And so people are coming into this archive and they're seeing the evidence of what they're feeling. This unthinkability is something we live with all the time in our bodies. So all of a sudden you're seeing the evidence. It's like, we did not make this up. This is happening, and this is what produced it. So there is so this is what I'm trying to do in my work, but I just want to say there are people, like Bushra doing that work. Shelley Hamilton's piece as well was really interesting, because it was really looking at the I guess the economic history through the materials. So using sugar, she made tiles that mirrored Portuguese the Portuguese tiles, and then she portrayed this ship, this merchant ship that would be going to the Caribbean, bringing molasses and all kinds of things made by enslaved people back to Newfoundland and trading for fish. So those kind of works are happening.
Yeah, no, I entirely agree with you. I think the works are happening. I think what's not happening is the language to make sense of the works. So for instance, when I say that, when I use that thing to describe your work, refusal, reconstruction, reparation, I can use that to describe the work of Sylvia Hamilton. I was thinking about, a show like Here We Are Here, for example, where a number of pieces in that show, read individually, they kind of breach the national border, right? There's always this sense of, but Here We Are Here was conceived as a show to produce a particular kind of presence within the Canadian nation state. And so one of the things that it seems to me that the art itself is grappling with is how to situate itself. And if there's anything that I think continues to lag in terms of when Andrea Fatona brought us together in 2014 to think about the state of Black art, what continues to lag is the state of Black art criticism. So what we've seen since 2014 or artists being able to show work, artists being able to the many group shows, but also many solo shows. I think of Deanna Bowen's multiple shows as one example of that. But what we have not begun to develop yet is a robust robust Black Canadian art criticism. The other thing that really made me frame that my haunting by Silva and my disappointment at MoCA Miami is the kind of question of how curators and curation travels. So one of the things that I grapple with as a critic looking at what's being produced and thinking about how to frame what's being produced is that I look around other parts of the Black diaspora and I see how curators from other parts of the Black diaspora champion work out of their own locations, how they travel with work, how the way in which they understand their own success as tied to work from out of their region. And that makes me raise questions about Canada in that sense. And I don't want to produce a kind of nationalist argument because I am far from interested in somehow securing the nation space of Canada as a bounded nation space. But it does raise for me the kind of question of the relationship between curation and criticism. So one of the things that since 2014 I've been thinking a lot about is the way in which we've had some really successful and interesting shows with African American artists at some of the major institutions. But what does that mean in relationship to the exhibition of Black Canadian artists? So of course, Andrea was right to mention Sandra Brewster's show Blur, to mention Winsome's show, and also Winsome's work in the show, was it on the 80s that Wanda did, Wanda Nana Bush did, and so on. So there's been all of that, but what we don't yet have is an apparatus that both takes the work elsewhere, which is not to say that Black Canadian artists don't show internationally, but what does it mean to take the work somewhere as part of a conversation about Black Canadian art making a visuality? And what does it mean to, and what would it mean to have a significant critical corpus? Of course, Charmaine Nelson published Toward an African Canadian Art History about a year or two ago, but yet and they have been increasingly essays in Canadian art by people like Yanya Lee and so on. But we are still in some infancy around how to talk about the work, how to produce a conversation about the work where we can talk about artists in relationship to traditions, in relationship to influence, and not in relationship to simply diversity, exclusion, or being seen at the national level.
That is true. Yeah, I think we do have a long way to go. I mean, as an artist, I'm always grappling with creating a visual sonic, a language to articulate as well. And it is really important to have that that kind of support. I remember a while back, Ken Montague brought Thelma Golden here, and I remember her talking about how, you know, she staked her career on Black American artists. I do remember that feeling like, wow, you know, at a time when, you know, people weren't, you know, that wasn't necessarily the way that people thought that their careers could grow as a curator. That commitment, that dedication, that that vision. Of course, there were all kinds of other social factors involved.
Of
and
course,
we're talking
right? And economic.
And economic. But I think in a way, right now is a time when this can happen. And I really hope that, you know, Black curators are taking note of this particular time, this particular convergence, this particular moment when, you know, there is a chink in the armor, you know, there is something happening. There is something. I actually really want to big up the activists on the ground, because I think this is what is producing what is going on right now. You know, the people that have been, you know, putting their bodies on the line for years, for decades, you know. I think about people like Cyrus Marcus Ware, who's an activist and you know, an artist. You know, I can't remember the quote now by Frederick Douglass. He talks about power concedes nothing without a demand. It never has and it never will. It's that continued demand. It's that continued holding, you know, the institution's feet to the fire that's producing the demand. So I think that this is a time when we see that institutions can't just keep making these trite statements of solidarity, that they really have to, you know, make space for Black leadership, by, you know, acquire the work by Black artists, you know, and some are doing so for the very first time. You know, Alyssa Fearon is out at the Dunlop Gallery, and, you know, she is just, they've just purchased the work of, I'm blanking now on her name, but
Liz.
Yes, Liz Acarico's work on the Black Prairies, which is so important. But this is the very first work by a Black artist that this institution has bought. So it's really important now that, you know, people are in strategic positions, but also, you know, there are opportunities to keep that pressure going, you know. With the confluence of, you know, of COVID, the public lynching of George Floyd, the deaths of so many Black people at the hands of the police, it was a very immobilizing time. But I really want to big up the activists who kept that pressure going. I think that that is producing this groundswell that we're seeing. But yeah, there is so much more work to be done.
Yeah, I mean, I think at the institutional level, we're at a really interesting place. So I think that, you know, the moves that the AGO has done with the global diaspora,
yeah,
and curator with Julie Crooks.
Yeah.
I think that's an interesting move. We've seen Black people enter boards like the Ontario Arts Council and now the Canada Council with Gitane Verna. But I think that one of the things that we have to really account for in thinking about what's at stake is whether or not the logic that people are entering these institutions under, which is the logic of equity, diversity, is the kind of logic that helps to produce and sustain art in the long run. And whether or not one representative figure can do the necessary work to produce the kind of discourse and the body and sustenance, the sustaining of a Black Canadian art practice and tradition that can begin to overturn centuries long forms of neglect. Because I think inclusion has come to modern neglect in a way that is not, at least for me, particularly useful. I guess the other thing that I want to say, I know Andrea is itching to jump in. She thinks that we've gone too long. but the other thing that I want to say is that even in this moment where activists have helped to produce a certain kind of reckoning with the institution, it's interesting to see that despite seeing a number, since 2014 to now, we've seen many more shows. It's been interesting to see sometimes how those shows have been positioned as special projects, positioned as still parts of the education program. I think, for instance, the wonderful show that Ellen Walker curated at Abdi Osman, Anime Histories at the Gardner, but it was done through a community art outreach program, vis-a-vis the show that was curated by Dina Georgeson, Sarah Matthews at the Art Museum. But then most recently, Pamela Edmonds worked with the ROM to have a portrait of Austin Clark made by a Black portrait artist, Neville Clark, unveiled. So it's a mixed match of things. And I think that we're in a moment where we're going to have to track what that mismatch actually is able to sustain.
Yeah, no, I totally agree. The sustainability is a really important one. You know, I'm in academia. I'm in academia because I could not figure out the sustainability as an artist, you know? And this is what happens to a lot of artists. Artists should not have to go to academia in order to create a sustainable life. You know, Black artists need to be cherished, you know? They need to be sustained. And so this is why I'm really excited about, you know, the work that this center can do, and the work that you know we all need to do to address this the sustainability.
Yeah. If I might say one last thing, Andrew, you can jump in whenever you're ready.
Let me say one last thing.
You know, recently when Canadian art launched their Chroma issue, was a conversation with Donald Woods that I thought was really instructive. Because that historic show that Donald Woods curated on Nova Scotian folk art, David Woods, yes. Sorry, I said Donald Woods. I got the other Donald in my head. David Woods remains for me a touchstone for the kind of point I was making in my opening comment, which is that we kind of need a show. We need an institution and curators to do the kind of show that marks a moment where we can never go back. That after that show, regardless of what it is, regardless of what it does, that it signals we can't go back. And that's what I'm taking from the Golden Method. She did a number of shows that made it so absolutely clear that there could be no turning back, that something had to be reckoned with, right? And it might not be that that all of the artists who I like or who speak to me become a part of that reckoning. But I'm very cautious around the way in which the reckoning is unfolding right now. Because as much as you and myself and Andrea are committed to a notion of Black diaspora, Black diaspora can also very easily disappear Canada. As you said, Canada gets disappeared all the time. And you invoke Michel Triault and the Unthinking. But there's another thing about Michel Triault's Silence in the Past that I like, and there's this phrase called retrospective significance.
Yes.
Right, and the retrospective is when we look back and we realize the importance of something. And it's exactly looking back at the David Woods and hearing him talk about the work that he did, the people that he had to go talk to, the folks who were making art but has simply been pushed aside or they only made art for a very small number of people in their community. The retrospective significance of that is really, really crucial. And, you know, Salafi many years ago in the 90s hinted at that possibility. But now I think we're in a moment where the investment for a massive national across eras show could do something to really sustain and change the conversation in an indelible way.
So I'm going to agree with you on that, Rinaldo, but I'm going to also bring it back to what you mentioned earlier, because I think it can only sort of really hint at or actually look back with any significance if this practice and process of refusal, and I would say reconstitution, takes place. I'm not quite at the place of reparation. I'm at a place of reparation in terms of psychic reparation, not necessarily.
That's what I'm talking about. Never economic reparation.
Okay. And so this idea of refusal for me is really important. Refusal about the vernaculars that we use to talk about ourselves. And I think this is what David points to. And I think through that refusal, one has to actually really ground oneself in the local, but the local as constitutive of a broader national, international, and as you say, outer national space. I think without those two things, it can't happen. I also think there needs to be a bit of a reconstruction, and that reconstruction has to happen on our terms as Black folks, as a way to, I think, dream, imagine, and build something that's outside of that framework that's kept us trapped, thinking that we have to work within these Euro-Western frameworks and argue our way in. So I feel that these are some of the moves that need to be made if we're gonna move forward. You talk about art criticism, but I also have to say that, you know, it also is really about art writing as well. We need to write about our works. We need to write about our works using the language that makes sense and the critical frameworks that make sense. And I'm proposing with this center that we start to use diaspora conceptually and practically as a way to do that rethinking and reimagining of these new spaces. So I'm just so happy for this conversation, but also the conversation of putting the question about how does our work travel, right? How do we carry the works and move the works forward outside of the space? And I think part of, you know, that traveling too, and this idea of the retrospective significance, we also have to think about our works in Canada as multiple Black Canadas. I think we get seduced into trying to shove it into a space of singularity as well. Mm-hmm. And we have to refuse that seduction, because it does become seductive for some of us, because it accrues particular forms of cultural capital for us, right? Mm-hmm. And I don't know if we talk about that as well as Black artists, cultural producers in this country, the kind of seduction that sort of staying within the frame of the national and accruing those sort of, cultural capital that really works within that framework of EDI, that, you know, equity, diversity, and inclusion that you're begging us to push away, Rinaldo. So I would actually like to ask you too, if you have anything else to say. I think this has been an incredible conversation that will lead to a lot of other conversations, but not just conversations. The need to do other kinds of projects to move some of these ideas forward, like refusal, reconstitution. And I'd like to continue our discussion at some other point around this notion of reparation and what it means, this reparation, what it means in, for us in terms of the kinds of relationalities that we need to construct in the space of Blackness, right? So those things that Thelma talks about, you know, I was so struck by things like the Black Audio Collective and the ways in which they worked with the Birmingham School of Race Relations way back then, right? To make these things fit together, but to also push against some of the kind of boundaries of thinking and create a more interdisciplinary space, multidisciplinary space of trying to figure out who we are.
Well, I guess one thing I would say, Andrea, though, that since 2014, for example, there are things which I would assume that you're a part of, like the formation of the Black Curators Forum. So those are, you know, if one might if one is, those are attempts to work within some kind of model that holds some kind of collective understanding of the institution and what curators want to do. You know, the collective model is always always seems to be a seductive model for artists. But I also wonder, and this was the thing that troubled me a little bit from my 2019 time at MoCA Miami. The unspoken in not being able to name other Canadian artists was because they were immediately a part of the art market. That's what was going on, right? Stan is a part of the art market, so he can be named and identified in a very particular way. So one of the things that we're grappling with, that we're gonna have to grapple with, is what does art do ultimately? And so different kinds of formations, of course, there's a formation called we critique. And I agree with you, there's art writing and then there's criticism. But I'm obviously speaking as a critic, as someone who's interested in spending my time thinking and writing about work that moves me, whether it's work that makes me angry, work that makes me happy, work that makes me think, what have you. I guess I'm saying all of that to say that there's a lot of things that we can do and a lot of things that we can hold all at the same time. And the question is whether or not what has happened since 2014 will allow us to do that, but allow us to do that in a way that we're not continually having to return to the ground of, well, Black Canadian visual culture has gone missing, has disappeared. And because that seems to come in at least 10-year cycles. And well, so, yeah.
I think that's the work of the center as well, to create traces, mm-hmm. not just traces, to create the evidence of it. We know it's here as Black cultural producers. So it's about creating spaces that we can easily identify it, know where it is. I would have to say that I'm not sure also that we can uncouple art from the economy at this point, right? Mm-hmm. And so this idea that Stan, right, he's in the art market, I feel like there's something else and much more complex things happening with the ways in which anti-Black racism constantly creates these spaces of unbelonging for us. So until we create our spaces of belonging, we're not going to be there. And so I am very, very excited for the support of my communities and you all to try to create a space in which we can make the mark and make it in a very indelible way. So thank you once again. Thank you so, so much. And we'll continue these conversations. Thank you, audience, for being here. Thank you, panelists. I'd also like to thank a number of folks who've made this session possible today. Again, thanks, Rinaldo and Camille. Thanks for being my friends as well. I won't hide that again. The senior leadership at OCAD, I'd like to thank President Serrano for the support of this project and the center. I'd like to thank past director and of the Research and Innovation, Robert Luke. I'd like to thank Dr. Ashok Mathur, Interim VP Research and Innovation at OCAD, Heather Robson, Director of Research Services, for ongoing support of the center and my work. I'd like to thank Dr. Yumi Goto, as well as Alex Gregory, Samantha Leggett, Catherine Ellis, Danica Willis, for IT support tonight, allowed everything to run so smoothly. I'd like to thank Saida Akbari, Renzi Gurin, and for PR support, Karen McCarthy from the Communications and Media Marketing Office at OCAD. Thank you, everyone. Thank you very, very much for being here tonight. And I'm really excited to get the program of collecting and making accessible the works of Black cultural producers over the past 45 years in Canada accessible to all of us. Thank you and have a good evening.
Everything. Is it good? Sorry.